Hello and welcome to this tutorial for sewing this plus size Victorian corset. We are going to start sewing at the center front. My favorite way to line up the busk and make sure everything is the way I want it to is to lay the outside pieces face up and then the strength layer pieces on top of that face down so it'll be right sides together. We're then going to mark the center front seam allowance on both sides, but we're going to start with the loop side of the busk. Now I always put this on the right side, assuming a right-handed wearer, this is the wearer's right side. But if you are left-handed, you can absolutely flip it over to the other center front piece. So all we're doing is marking that half-inch seam allowance. I'm going to do little tick marks for where the seam allowance hits at the top and bottom edges, and then I'm also going to mark like a quarter inch or so past that on each edge to show the space that the binding will take up. So we want the busk to fit in between those little marks. You can see here that my busk is just a little bit longer than I had hoped. If this happens to you, it's totally okay to cheat this edge and just make a little less seam allowance. It just means that your front piece is going to be a tad bit longer than you had planned for. So then you go down and mark little hashes on each side of the loop. It's fine to give it a little bit more room. And then we're going to sew the long pieces of the seam in between, but leave open gaps for the loops. Now we come back after those are all nice and pressed. You can put the loop side of the busk. Right in between the seam allowances, like so, so that it pops out the edge. Next step will be to put a zipper foot on the machine and sew right next to that steel piece. If you want to make sure that it's very, very even, you could baste this into place by hand before you sew it on the machine. Next, we are marking for the stud side of the busk. Just lay them on top, mark little dots, and then we use an awl to poke through. This fabric is very, very dense, and it doesn't love to be forced apart by the awl. And in this case, I would say it's totally fine to use like a very small punch if you are trying with the awl and it's not giving you a nice result. Punch is fine as well. So we're going to go ahead and do that the whole way down where we've marked. And sew that side of the buskin same as we did for the loop side. You see how the edges are open. So moving forwards, we're going to sandwich seam on this next piece. And so when I say sandwich seam, let me show you what I mean. We're going to work from the center front around to the back of the corset, totally enclosing the seams as we go. And we're going to do this by applying the next pieces like this, right sides together on both sides, sewing the whole seam at the same time and then pressing towards the center back. So take that away and sew it and come back and show you. Like so, you can trim down the seam allowance of your bulkiest layer if you need to. You can also clip curves at this point if you need to. Next will be to insert the bust gores. So I've done one side already so that you can see it. Since it has this extra little quilty bit at the top, we have to do that first before we can apply it onto our main corset piece. I've marked a seam line, And I'm going to apply this little scrappy bit of fabric right sides together, stitching it through all layers. And then press up. After that, you can sew the quilting lines again through all layers from the top. And then we have this cute little reinforced bust gore. And the reason we do this is to control the stretch at the top of the triangle, so it's nice and stretchy in the rest of the cup, but the top will still be a controlled edge. So then we seam this onto the strength layer, like so. And then we are going to fold the top layer so that the fold matches right up with the seam we've just sewn. Pin it perpendicular and stitch as close as you can to that edge. And that's going to look like this under the machine. It's fun to take your time with these top stitch seams. This particular seam technique is going to come back in a few more places. And as long as you're nice and slow, take your time, your fabric is not too stretchy, it's gonna look so beautiful. Now let's do a little backstitch. And then on this particular design, I also run another line of stitching about a quarter inch away. And at this point is when I go ahead and finish the seam that we had sewn earlier, putting piece two onto piece one. And it's going to get pretty much the same treatment. We're just top stitching through all layers, like a millimeter or two away from the pressed fold. Check the marking on pieces like this, because in some cases this is going to be a bone channel. In other cases, it's just a little bit of seam reinforcement. So now piece three is getting applied in exactly the same manner. We've made another little bust triangle piece. However, we're going to put it on to piece four first, before we put it onto the rest of the corset that we've already assembled, using our handy little envelope seam. Alrighty, so this gets a little complicated. Piece five is going to get fully corded, and so we have to be thinking about how that's going to attach. The next step is going to be stitching the majority of the bone channels down the center of piece four. That's going to be relatively straightforward. We are going to use a ruler and mark, but then we need to leave enough room to do what I've just shown and have the seam allowance plus another 3/8 or so to turn under. So I'm going to mark, apparently by eye, the same line that I've marked on the pattern piece, and then do parallel lines from there out to the edge of the piece. And you can mark these ahead of time with a pen and a ruler, or you can just let the foot do all the work for you. I like to put a little pin there at the start to help the grain not shift too bad. And here we go, it's parallel lines time. If you've ever made 18th century stays, you may have done a process similar to this, especially if you've done the old Record and Smith, like the fully boned ones. That's kind of what we're going for in this piece. It's going to be like a solid block of, I think I used 5mm synthetic whalebone for this particular piece. Oh yeah, this is So I had a piece of the whalebone. And I would just give myself like an extra 2 or 3 millimeters and just write like these little hash marks for the starts of the channels and then look at how wide it was with the foot and stitch it all the way down. It's a very like chaos crafter way to do this. You could definitely mark them out ahead of time. And here we are. You can see we've left a little bit of space on the far edge of this piece, but now it is time to attach piece 4 to the rest of the corset that we've already sewn, and it's going to be sewn just to the strength layer. And then it's all pressed toward piece 3 at the moment. Piece 3 is now going to get that same little foldy top stitchy treatment that we did for the bust gore on piece 2. So it gets a little more complicated the longer the seam is. I really like to do the pinning part of this technique on as corsety of a shape as I can get, like as close to the shape of the body that's going to be wearing it as I can get. The main thing though is just to make sure that the outer fabric has enough ease to handle that slight curve around the body. What we don't want to happen is if you pin it on a flat surface, especially with some of the silks, the cotille layer, like the strength layer, is actually a little more stretchy than the satin, and that's how you start getting like big wrinkles and stuff in the cotille layer, but not in the satin layer. So definitely pin this on some kind of curve. It can be a seam roll, it could be like a wine bottle, like really anything. And now this is also, it looks so pretty. This is the half inch steel that is going to go down the middle of this piece, and it is quite a tight fit, so I'm doing my same little chaos crafter method of marking the distance for the channel just at the top and then kind of eyeballing the width all the way down with my sewing machine foot. This piece in the pink satin and the smaller strength layer piece in cotille, and try to distribute the extra of the satin equally on both sides of this little line that I've given you to start. So I use 1.5 millimeter waxed cotton cording, round cotton cording, to do this cording. As you can see, I just kind of wedge it in there with my fingernails. You could use like a screwdriver or some pointy tool or something. And just zipper foot stitch this in till the whole piece is corded. I always like to work up from that line toward the top edge first. And then just turn it around and work down. Sometimes I cut the next like 5 to 10 little cording bits at a time. It gets a little hairy as you keep going, but you try to keep the angle even. And then after all the cording is done, I started on 5, but 8 is similar, but just flipped, so we're going to do the same thing to both. So you can cord all 4 of those side pieces at once, and then after they're all corded, we can go ahead and trim them. For this, do pay very careful attention to where your strength layer ends when you're lining up this piece and deciding what to cut off and what to leave, because you don't want to leave any like big holes where there's just a bunch of cords and satin but no strength layer. I use the rotary knife to trim this. It makes it so smooth and so easy. how we get our fully corded pieces. And you can see too that I cut that hip edge seam allowance off entirely, that like chompy bite over the hip, and that is because that is about to get some bias binding. So we don't need the seam allowance in that area at all, but I find it helpful to leave it on in the cording step just to help with if it skews at all, then you have some extra. And so I cut these straight green 1-inch wide strips, and I stitch them on about 1/4 inch away from the edge. You could definitely cut bias if you want. I like straight green. I feel like it helps me control this edge a little bit more. And I use straight green strips for the top and bottom edges as well. Because I feel like bias just lets the edge stretch a little too much. So after we press it towards the edge, we then do this nice little fold, like so, right over the edge. Sorry for my scorchy ironing board. Oh my gosh. And just press it. You could also pin it if you like. I used to pin my bias bindings in my bound edges, and it would just tear at my hands when I was stitching it into the machine. And I really like just pressing it. It works so well. And it stays very nicely if you put a, it's just like a IKEA spice rack wooden plank that it helps take all the extra moisture out really quickly and gives you sharp presses. So then we're gonna stitch in the ditch from the front side so that it catches the binding on the back side. Like so. Alright, and next we're going to be talking about these little hip pieces that are only on the bottom edge. You can do this with only catil, in that case serge or bias bind at the top. In this case I'm covering it in pink silk as well, so I've just seamed it at the top. But the corded pieces are going to lay over these bottom hip pieces like so. And we are going to baste them in place along the edges that they share, along the lower edges of these side seams. The cording is really thick. It might be better to use like Wonder Clips or something, not pins. But yeah, that's what it looks like from the back. We're gonna do this on both sides. I will give you an actual point to match it to on the paper pattern so you don't have to guess like I did from the antique version of this pattern. But a great way to double check it is that this piece 7, which is going to go like, it's like right on the side, check that piece 7 is still the right length, and that the corded pieces are going to fit onto piece 7. That is a great way to make sure that you don't have too much curve or too little curve, that you've like pivoted it off in one direction or another. Alright, and while we're here, we're going to go ahead and mark those decorative stitching lines. I'm marking about 1/2 inch away from where that bound edge is. And you can put these, if you're doing piece 6 and 9 as like a single layer catil as well, it will just help control the stretch in that area a little bit and allow it to stretch more below the stitch line. So now it's time to go ahead and baste these pieces together and sew those little quilted bits through all layers on the machine. You can see already I've done the short edge just a little bit inside the 3/8 seam allowance. And we're going to go ahead and do the same thing on the other side. And here we are stitching those little quilted hip details through both the satin and the catil layers. Just take the time, make a nice curve. now it is finally time to attach this beast of a piece. We're gonna sew our new corded attached thing to just the strength layer of piece 4. And now you can see why we left a little bit of space for ourselves. And then this edge is going to get the same little foldy pinny finish. Oh, we gotta press it first. Yeah, press it all towards piece 4. I'm not gonna show you this earlier. This is how I press these pieces from the back. I feel like it's somehow a little bit neater, and then you don't have to risk scarring the satin. Now for piece 7, you have two different options. You can do corded, like I have here, and that's a much softer waist. If you do the cording, you have to do it before you attach piece 7 to the two corded sides. But the other option is that you can do it exactly as we did piece 3 and put a metal bone down it, which will give you a little more waist definition and support those edges and really hold them apart. So I'm going to show you how to do the corded version. What we're going to do for this is start with a line either right in the center or centering a cord, depending on how, like, what cording you're using and how many pieces are going to fit. I aim for basically fully corded plus about a 3/8 space on either side to do the little reinforced seam method that we like to do. You could even put smaller bones in those pieces. That would be a great way to sort of get two birds with one stone. Get a little more reinforcement, but also make it still a very soft and flexible side. So cording this is going to go the same method as it was for the other pieces. You are an expert at cording by this point, I know. So these will be like, lickety split, so fast. You can see on the paper pattern a little bit what I was talking about leaving that 3/8 room. If you have cut your satin like more wide than you need for all that cording, this is a great time to trim it down, because now is when we're going to do the seam. And for this, it's going to be sewing the corded side to only the strength layer of piece 7, and then folding the top layer under and top stitching, as we've done for a couple other pieces so far. One thing I'd like to show you just real quick is that this seam allowance is quite bulky due to all the cording and the many layers, so what we're going to do is trim it down. I think I probably trim about half of this off. Yep. And once again, the rotary cutter is our friend. Just make sure the rest of everything else is very out of the way so you don't ruin all your hard work. Oh, there we go. And that looks a little more doable. Go ahead and attach the back corded piece, piece 8 and 9, onto the other side of piece 7. Same method. Wow, you're going to be so good at this by the time it's all done. Alright, moving on to the back now. We're going to start actually with piece 11, sewing the center back seam. I have given this a wider seam allowance of 1 inch, so do look at that and don't accidentally make your corset too big in the back. I like to just mark this same as we did for the busk with the right sides together just to make it easier to sew, and then turn it and press. We're going to mark some channels for the center back grommet area and go ahead and sew these on piece 11 before we attach it to anything else. And so we want two bones to be on both sides of the grommets. I also like to stitch right along the edge, like a millimeter or two away first, because it just makes everything nice and flat. So piece 10 is going to get a similar treatment as piece 4 did. It's just going to be like a solid piece of smaller bones. First thing we're going to do is sew it onto piece 11 though, with that same little envelope seam method. Grade the seam allowances if you need, and then just press everything out towards piece 10, like so. I haven't shown you anywhere else, but this is how I press from the right side when I need to press on top of this silk satin. It's just an old scrappy cotton muslin press cloth. I can see through it, so don't worry, I'm not gonna press my hand. You could also use like a piece of silk organza or organdy if you really want a little more transparency. That's again, my little trusty wicked pink. And you can see I've done a tiny top stitch through all layers. And I've also added another seam line for it's another bone channel on piece 11. So piece 10 has some diagonal bones. We're going to mark and do the top chunk of boning first. They're going to be these that hit piece 11 at an angle. Those are going to really keep that top edge from kind of collapsing into the middle at all. Keep it stretched out more towards the side. I love seeing this detail on this very like 1890s corset actually, because it's something that I'm so used to seeing in like 1860s corsets. This turn 90 though, it's not so simple always. That was a little bit of an angle. You could also just take your ruler and mark lines out. Yeah, you know, like that, parallel to that first longer line. Oh yeah, and then after you do the top chunk, go like from 11 towards the side of 10 to do the bones that are straight up and down with the piece. So you could sew these through both layers any way you want, but I think I'm showing you this because when you get to the end of this seam, you could do a little back tack, but sometimes it looks a little messy from the surface. So what you can also do instead is leave yourself a bit of tail when you snip the thread like this. If you kind of pull on the bobbin thread, it'll pull the needle thread through, make a little loop. You can use a pin or like a scissor tip as I am here to kind of catch that loop and pull it through. So now you have both the bobbin thread and the needle thread on the wrong side together. You just tie them together in a little knot, or just a nice little square knot. And clip the ends, and if you really wanted, you could, you know, put a little frayed check or nail polish or something on your knot. But I love those because it just looks so much cleaner from the right side than having a little back tack, especially if you're using a thicker thread. Like, I love the Mara 70 thread from Guterman for sewing these like antique-y style corsets, because it's just a little bit thicker than the Mara 100, which is the more usual like dress sewing weight thread that they carry. And it really makes all the top stitching stand out so nicely. So here's the finished piece 10 and 11 combined. You can kind of see what's going on, and that I have again left myself like an extra 3/8 of room to attach this combined piece 8 and 9. That's going to get sewn on as we did for the other according piece. I also like to kind of steam out these areas where I've stitched like a whole bunch of lines all in a row. For some reason they always seem to get like a little bit puckery and tight, and all they need is just a little steam and a little stretch to make them nice and smooth again. Putting all the bones in will help as well, so don't get too discouraged if it's looking a little wrinkly at this point. Like, putting all the bones in will help, and then once you put it on an actual person, that will again help stretch out any wrinklies that may be happening. So yeah, we go ahead and do our nice little foldy trick seam method. And I don't think I told you on the other piece that now is the time that we are sewing another line to make a channel along the seam, and finishing up, if you've left space on 10, you can put those last, you know, bone channel or two on that piece that you waited to do. And now it is binding time. Oh my gosh, you're so close. We like to go ahead and mark along. We're going to do the top edge first. I marked the extra quarter inch there to show what the binding will take up, because before we bind the top edge, we need to put the bones in just for this one little triangle chunk, because it's not open at the bottom edge like all the other channels are, and it will be all closed up very soon. So I'm using, yeah, 5/6 mil synthetic whalebone. You can of course cut it however you like. When I have channels like this that hit at an angle, I actually do like to cut them with an angle, and I still round the angle, and of course, round the top square edge. Just a nail file works so well. This is a metal file, but nail files work even better. Because I feel like when the angled end is in there, it spreads out the strain a little better than it would if it was just like cut at a 90 degree angle and then rounded. But you do. And put all the rest in. Oh, don't you wish it was that easy? So nice. Yeah, you can start to see how it's gonna look. Yeah, I told you before I like to use these straight grain strips. And we just stitch those on. The seam allowance at the top edge is all going to be cut off when this is done, so we're going to stitch the binding on our like quarter inch inside where that seam allowance is marked. I like to pre-mark right at the center front while the busk is done up, so that you can make sure both pieces are going to be even. This edge right where the busk is can be kind of annoying to get started. I often end up having to like walk it with my hand on the wheel. You could pin this in place before you sew it. I find it easier to just kind of apply it as I go, and that way I can like stretch it with my fingers around the curves or ease it as needed. After it's all sewn on, then we go ahead and press it. Here we do the same thing that we did for the little bit of binding that went over the hip pieces. Actually, this is a really great shot to see those hip pieces. You can see how they're open. But for the edge binding, I love to fold it over the short edge first and make sure that that line is like a continuation of the center front busk. And then you can fold it like this. And once again, just kind of press as you go, you know, in each little like 6-8 inch length. I really do find this so much faster and so much less frustrating than trying to pin the whole thing. But once again, you do you, whatever works best for you. Go ahead and bind both top edges once you've got the bones in piece 10 back there on the top. I've laid the steel bones on top just so you can see where they would go. I'm showing you what it looks like when I cut bones for the rest. I just kind of lay it on there and use a pencil to mark and then trim. Do leave yourself like an extra 1/4 inch of room with the bones if you're going to do like decorative flossing. But if not, it's nice to get them right up there to the edge. Go ahead and bind that bottom edge, same as we did for the top. Well, yeah, and if you want to get a little more tummy control in your corsets, this is what you do. You just bend the bottom half of the busk around your fingers, or you can use like a table edge or something too, until it's starting to get a nice little curve. And the main point of this is just to let the tummy push it out so that it's flat and not like that dish out that can happen sometimes. We're going to go ahead and do the grommets for the back now. I'm just kind of wigged this placement, apparently. I'll put marks for you on the pattern. That would be nice. If you find yourself with a corset pattern that has no grommets marked, my favorite way to kind of place them is to pull on it to find where the waist is and put two closer together at the waist and then space it out from there. For tight lacing corsets, I like to put them about 2 centimeters apart, the grommets up and down. For kind of more everyday corsets, you can do as much as like 1 or 1.5 inches even. I'm going to show you how I did these cute little purple V's next. Only the steel bones really need them in this context, I find. It just kind of helps take the strain at the edges so that the bone isn't, like, pushing against one of the fabric layers. So for this, I'm using buttonhole twist, silk buttonhole twist, from 2A Threads. That's the needle. Oh. I love doing this wrapping quilter's knot trick to start my threads. Buttonhole twist is a very, very, very high twist thread, and it loves to be tangly, so pull slowly, and that way you can kind of untangle any knots that happen, like, as you go. If you just try to, like, rip the thread through, it's going to tangle and you're going to have a bad time. So to do these little V's, I start on the right side, about 1 inch up from like where the binding is, I would say. You can do it shorter or longer as you like. And then we go like just a little bit left of center. And we go up to the left, about the same height. And go like just a tiny bit right of center. And then we're gonna keep following that pattern, maybe a millimeter or two up and then out at the bottom edge. I would say a minimum of 3 stitches, like 3 lines of purple thread. For the steel bones that are a little wider, I really like to do like 5 to 7 threads on each side of the V's, and they sort of start to become more like X's I don't know, I think just the wider X helps balance out like the extra width of the bone. For the more like usual 6 or 7 millimeter bones, you know, just do like 3 or 4 threads usually. It's very cold today. I think this is going to be the last stitch. Sorry, my head's in the way. Oh, just kidding. One more round. Oh yeah, you can see the thread start to like loop up on itself. You just sort of have to like periodically untwist when you work with this thread. I really like working with like shorter lengths of it as well for just that reason. Like if you have a whole arm long piece, it's going to get so tangly so fast. There we go. So now to finish this up, we flip over to the other side. I like to take like a teeny little 2 millimeter stitch through the fabric, wrap it around, and pull it. It's sort of a variation of the quilter's knot that we started with. And then to bury the tail, take a longer stitch like over where the bone is or something, and then clip it. And that is how we do corset flossings. You could definitely get fancier than that and add flowers and whatever neat little decorative things. But now we're gonna lace it up. You can look up different corset lacing patterns online. My favorite one though is one that makes like complete X's on top and then also complete X's underneath so that it could totally close edge to edge if needed. And then I leave these 2 long loops at waist level. Like that. And we keep going with the X pattern. When you get down to the bottom edge, you're going to tie the ends together. And then when you put this corset on, you don't untie this lacing at all. You just kind of wiggle it to be as loose as it needs to be to get the bust closed in front. And then you pull on these long loops that are at waist level and tie them together as you need. And I love this because it lets you kind of adjust the ribs and the hips independently. Like you can pull on the top of the loop to adjust only the ribs and the bottom of the loop to adjust only the hip. And I find it distributes the strain much better as well. Like if you do it just sort of shoelace style, it always sort of wants to creep to one edge or another. So this is my favorite way. I've also seen this called bunny ears lacing. Because you need 2 long bunny ears, like at waist level. And voila, you have a corset. It's time to go try it on.